There are stats that show that the number one precipitator of divorce between couples who have been married already, where they're either making equal or the man's making more and the woman gets a raise in pay of some sort, so she gets a promotion or something like that, is the number one precipitator for divorce.
Well, exactly.
The other part is this, is that also women find men who do not make as much money as they do as economically undesirable. There's plenty of stats for this. And women, from the polls that they've done up to now anyways, they expect that man to make 68% more than she already makes. Mm-hmm. Now, then you've got more women going to university, you've got more women on OnlyFans, you've got more women making more money right now, and yet the expectation still stays the same.
Also
in the most gender egalitarian countries on planet Earth.
Right. Almost half of U.S. households right now have women making as much, the same, or more than the husband. And I agree with you, because women don't want, one of the things that happens in divorce is women are far more likely to have their standard of living go down. They're more likely to seek government assistance.
In the long term, yes. In the short term, no.
Okay,
I really wanted to make sure I clarify this, because everyone says, oh yeah, women's standard of living, and they take a financial hit and they do worse off after divorce. And the funny thing is they still choose to leave. But the thing is, and this, I'm going to quote James Sexton here, is in the short term, that is, women do way better. In the long term, they don't. Because when the man is already coming back and already paying child support and already paying alimony after that, then you're seeing the transfer of resources from that man to that woman afterwards. Is that here's the real crux of this, is that the incentive for the divorce in the first place? And that's where we can debate that.
The problem is
you still have to get past one really big hurdle. Men are 8 times more likely to kill themselves
I 100% agree.
A divorce.
So I saw you guys.
That's the ultimate, down. That's a big downside for divorce, right?
Yeah,
there.
No, I completely agree with you guys. And actually, I saw. I love Richard Reeves. I think Richard Reeves is of Boys and Men is a great book. I think everyone should read it. Like, I like a lot of the stuff he talks about there, but. I just feel like, yes, a woman who is resources, who's able to take care of herself, is going to not be as likely to stay in a shitty situation. I think that's really clear. But also that women want these men that are better than them in all these ways. This is changing as society is changing. And
it is not, because the machine hasn't changed in 200,000 years.
Yeah, I find it hard to believe that, you're talking about cultural changes, but our evolution isn't going to change. Like, when women, when they're surveyed about when they make more money, they want men who make even more money than them.
And this is the argument made about hypergamy going down.
As the scale keeps going up, it's not like, well, I make $1 million a year, so I need a boyfriend who only makes, $50,000. It actually goes up even higher.
Escalation.
There's a great study, Institute of Labor Economics. The study's called the Economics of Hypergamy. And this was even looking at, since the 1800s to 2022, over 33 million marriages. Women typically marry men that are of the same status, and they're looking at all these countries.
Well, they kind of have to. I mean,
most people mate across.
Since the 1880s, but that's the thing. That's because that's what we had. Right, so if you lived in Des Moines, Iowa, in 1910, then yes.
Your sexual marketplace is
only going to be the people in Des Moines, Iowa, in 1910, who are about the same socioeconomic class as you are.
So hypergamy is only recent, but you're saying it's like
No. What I'm saying is hypergamy, like your ability to get to Drake, has only been since Instagram came around.
So women in all these since Drake. The 1800s, they wanted those better men, but they just couldn't get them.
They didn't have access to them. Just like we didn't have access to pornography, they didn't have access to celebrities.
Well, I think everyone wants, if they have access to something better than them, even men or women, they're going to want it. Like,
sure.
I don't think, but
that's
in general, people tend to mate across IQ, across socioeconomic status, and people
because
tended to marry
their,
even
that was
across
the environment
all these...
in which hypergamy was allowed to be expressed. So if you go and you look at things prior to the sexual revolution, we had the church, family stigmas. Again, I'll give you a quick for instance. Single mothers prior to the sexual revolution was a cultural, social stigma. It was a shame. They had to put that woman away so she could have the baby and give it to the grandparents or whatever else. Today, that woman is treated as a superhero.
Yeah.
She can now do. That's the difference, by the way, in just the last 60 years, which is a blink of an eye in human evolution right now. So what I'm saying is this, is that we used to have buffers and checks and balances against men's sexual nature, which is unlimited access to unlimited sexuality. And we also had buffers against the worst parts of hypergamy, okay? Meaning we had the church, we had social stigmas, we had family, we had mores that were buffers against those. Now those things are gone with the advent of hormonal birth control and the sexual revolution that was the result.
Wait, so you're saying, can I...
Real fast.
It was always there. It just was the expression of it.
And to personify this...
exist in the context has only been within the last, like, 65 years.
So you're saying that hypergamy was always just what they wanted, even though mating practices have not mirrored this?
Yes, because we have one invention that allows us to see...
But then even now...
I think the confusion, because I've had this discussion before, I think the confusion may be hypergamy is just money. You want a man who's taller than you, and if you have to stratify amongst several men, the man who may be taller than the rest of them, you have to choose between several men who are 5'6 and one who's 6'3, you're more attracted to the guy who's 6'3.
And men are more attracted to the woman.
Correct. That's hypoandry, then that's what that'd be called. That's not the issue. My point is the idea that hypergamy didn't exist before, it still existed before. Whenever I hear this argument, it's like, well, because people of the same socioeconomic group married each other, therefore no hypergamy. No, hypergamy is everything. Hypergamy is he is stronger than the other man. Mm-hmm. It's not the best man you can get, it's the best man you can't get.
Yeah, but you guys, what I'm saying is you guys are saying this is what women want, but the practices that have actually been, women marry men that are taller than them, so that physical part maybe, although I wouldn't say they're more
the tallest,
the man wants the most beautiful woman. True. Yeah. So what I'm saying is you're saying hypergamy was just what women wanted, even though it hasn't been reflected in mating practices, and even now, almost half of women are making as much or more or almost the same as the men. So when exactly was hypergamy just exploding, and other than on dating apps where people are just swiping, when is it actually, what real world evidence do you have of hypergamy actually determining mate selection? Because it doesn't seem to be there.
The Tinder, Bumble, and Hinge is part of
it. But that's not reflected in the real world. Like, that's
how is that not reflected in the real world?
Maybe it's proving the point that this is what women want, but what people actually do in real life,
what
people do.
You work on OnlyFans. It's right there.
Let's talk about the average.
We have 28% of sexless men. Hold on. We have 28% of men.
Where are you getting 28% of sexless men?
Between the ages of 18 to 30, these men have had no sex in the last year.
What year?
But that went from 2014 to 2018.
We're trying to update it all of a sudden.
2022, mm-hmm. It's not that. It's between 12 to 15% that I've had zero sexual partners.
And
it's
been on a steady decline since 1989, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, because younger people. So, in fact, 25 to 30, GSS 2022, 8% of men reported zero sexual partners.
Right up until 2020 when it fell off a cliff and then went right back up to where it is.
No, all you're it's do, not. All you're it's do,
see, here's the thing is everybody wants to look at that GSS study. They want to look at just what's happened since, 2019 to where we are right now. As opposed to the fact that it was from 1989 all the way to 2018, which is the time shift for that entire study.
No, I mean, the 2018 was like the year that all the incels, red pillars took that graph, because that was actually an anomaly, even when you looked at years before, and especially when you looked at years after.
By the way, that's that you're looking at is one data point among probably dozen.
It was an anomaly from 2008 when the iPhone was created till 2018.
Because 2018, the 28% of men who reported zero sex, that wasn't in any other year that when that one GSS 2018 study that hasn't been there and for zero partners, and then every year, even before and after, it's been less. And especially when you look at 25 and up, because 18 to 25 have lower, they're doing everything less. They're having less sex. They're more likely to be virgins, everything. As soon as you go 25 and up, do you know what the rate of virgins for men 25 and over are? It's like 2%. Look that up. For 25 and over, the rate of virgin males are like less than 2%.
I don't necessarily think a man not being a virgin means that he's doing well sexually. It just means that he's had sex one time.
If we looked at the most recent data we have between 18 and 30, it's 12 to 15% of men. And if you look at 25 and up, it goes way down. And 25 to 30, it's 8% of men.
But it has to progressively go down. Like, once I have sex, then I can't go back to not having
sex.
But
I'm saying those people have one sexual, like, if we look at just in the past year, in 2022, and you look at 25 to 30, 8% of men reported zero sexual partners. Sure. So what's the contention?
God damn, what the fuck? All right, Chang.
Well,
hold on. I wanted to, besides the sexless one, because you were saying, like, how was hypergamy personified now, right? So you got to... Okay, so more and more women are meeting men online, right? I think somewhere between 20 to 50% of new marriages, they met online, right?
Less than half of women are online, though. Like, less than half of women use dating apps.
I understand that, but there's it's growing exponentially. It used to be, we go back 10 years, right? Mm-hmm. It used to be kind of taboo to be on a dating app.
Yeah. Now, what the number one dating app on planet Earth is?
Yeah.
Instagram.
Yeah, and they don't keep data for that. So so what I was going to say was, like, with the conventional dating apps, it's growing in the popularity of people meeting. And then on top of that, you add an Instagram, right? Because a lot of girls are meeting guys on Instagram as well. So you're saying, well, okay, how is hypergamy personified? If you look at the dating apps, women swipe right on Tinder, like, on only 5% of the guys. On Bumble, most guys are virtually invisible. I think, like, 88% of men are invisible because women screen for 6 feet tall. That's a component of hypergamy. And here's the other thing, too. You got to understand that hypergamy is a multivariate situation. What that means is women screen for a multitude of different things. Height, income, competence, aesthetics, teeth, physicality, all these different things come into it. So whether it's not just for money, because you're looking at it like from a money perspective. But what I am saying is that women, right, even though they say, oh, I want an egalitarian and equal partnership, they don't necessarily they're not attracted to that. Well, or they're not aroused by that.
So I agree with you about dating apps, but dating apps, we've seen time and time again, that data is not reflected into real life. This idea that this percent of men is having sex with all these women isn't borne out by the data. There seems to be a percentage of sociosexual women, and there seems to be a percentage of promiscuous men, and they seem to be fucking each other. That seems to be what's going on with that.
Yeah, but
what you're saying about being
that are promiscuous is a minority of men.
Yeah, and it's also a minority of women. And what I'm saying, it's not just this minority of men that's having sex with all the women. There seems to be 10% of women around that are high in sociosexuality. They're more likely to have casual sex, and those women and the men that are also high in that are kind of sleeping with each other. Most people, if you look at all the GSS data from the past few years, over 80% of people are having sex with one person that year. There seem to be having sex in relationships. Also, when you talk about height, you're right. On dating apps, because we have no choice. Every time I've used them, I go 6 feet and up too. Otherwise, I'm going to get way too many men.
So that's hypergamy.
No, but when you actually look at what's happening in real life, ResearchGate did a big thing on this. It was like over 60,000 men, and they looked at BMI, they looked at height.
Yeah,
and
that
they,
does have an effect.
No, it doesn't.
Absolutely, it does. In fact, I can show you divorce stats of people who are overweight.
Pull up.
That I do have.
That, the research, at least when it comes to number of sexual partners, lifetime sexual partners, extremely short, and then there was extremely short, at whatever, and then extremely tall. Between extremely short and extremely tall, there was a difference of 3. You have 3 more partners.
Yeah, but
when they looked at BMI too, it was the same. It's not like it makes.
And then here's the other thing too, because I want to talk, because you're talking about this hypergamy, how is it personified? And then, like, again, we talked about this before, like in the 1800s, whatever that you were talking about before, marrying across social status, etc. Cool. But you got to remember, they were limited to their own geographic area. So a girl, right, she was only limited to the people in her neighborhood that her family knew, etc., in her town at best, right? But now, thanks to the internet, thanks to Instagram, etc., that has completely changed the game. And who's it changed the game for is women, because it's given women more options. It's created this aura of their grass is always greener on the other side. And here's the other thing, too. I can't tell you, and hell, you do this as well. Women always say, oh, I have so many guys in my DMs. I have so many men that approach me, etc. You are absolutely lying if you're not going to tell me that that does not influence your mating strategies. Because when you know that you have a bunch of guys in the pipeline, you can go ahead and afford to be way more picky and way more nitpicky on certain things that aren't that really big. But that's why women are so selective nowadays, where most guys don't qualify, because they have a huge arsenal of men that are willing to date them. So what's effectively happened thanks to technology is it's actually made hypergamy stronger.
But what I mean is, why is that then not borne out? Because even now, people tend to marry across socioeconomic status, across IQ, even across physical attractiveness. So why are we not seeing, with the advent of dating apps, that now all these, like, Starbucks women are marrying lawyers? It's not happening.
Well, here's the thing. You're going to see it in the next 5 to 10 years, once we actually have a good amount of time elapsed where social media, right, has been used.
Yeah.
Because
I'll tell you exactly why
Hold on. Even in the past 5 years alone, there's been a drastic change in social media and usage and dating apps, etc. So we don't have the data yet. We're probably not going to see the data on the effects of what's going on now for another 5 to 10 years.
There was a 2022 study that looked at fraternity. Sorry, I know. They looked at that. Well, you told me that I'd come here for a debate. The 2022 study looked at a. They looked at fraternities and they looked at these so-called chads that get all these swipes, and they didn't seem. They had like a 4-point-something% increase in partners. It wasn't like Tinder going into these colleges were actually
I don't mean to be rude, but can we like allow other people to speak?
Yeah. Yes. Thank you.
If you got something to say,
So to your point, right?
Oh, okay.
Regarding dating apps, dating apps itself is manifesting women's true nature. Again, women didn't magically say, 6 feet tall, good looking, it's naturally in them. So dating apps, it came about on the internet. I'm just saying before, it was always there.
But with dating apps, we have nothing. Like, if I go on a dating app, I don't care if a guy's 6 feet tall, but I have to select for something. But you can't otherwise. But what I'm trying to say is I have no choice but to screen for those superficial things. That's why a lot of women don't use them. That's why men are outnumbering women 3-1, 5-1 on these dating apps. Women don't like it.
They're outnumbering men 5-1 and 3-1 because they're not getting sex. They're plight. That is the reason.
Why don't more women use them? Why do less than like 40% of women use them?
Honestly, because women
because you have Instagram.
Because women on because women in, because women in every culture are less interested in casual sex than men, and these dating apps are for casual sex. But the point was wasn't whether or not you have sex on there. The point was, did you find these other people attractive? Huh. If the top 20% of men are getting 83% of the right swipes, but the top 43% of women are getting 63% of the right swipes, that means in general men, the distribution for men is equal and the distribution for women is shifted to the left.
I understand that. But in real life, that's the thing. Like, if I go on a dating app, all I'm going to screen for, because I can only talk to 10 people, are the most attractive. But in real life, I don't give a fuck about that. So that's why I don't
talk. I was bored, too.
So listen, real quick. Dating apps, right? Even before dating apps, didn't you worry about men's height or, for example, their looks off-rip without dating apps?
Yeah.
For you?
What was the question? I'm sorry.
So the question is, right? Before dating apps, right? Before you rebound.
You could do this with a yes or no.
Yeah.
All right, ladies, get your things ready. Before dating apps. Go ahead. Go ask your question.
How did you select for men? Was it height? Was it looks? For example, did dating apps actually change your opinion of how you look for men?
Did dating apps change? No.
So from the very beginning, it was in you to want.
Hold on. If it's a no, give me a thumbs down. If dating apps did not change your preferences in men, okay. All right, mostly girls are saying it did not change their preferences.
So
okay,
hypergamy
only two
was
did.
Always there from the very beginning.
Okay. But what I mean is, you may say, okay, if your argument is women want this, women all want men that are 6 feet tall, fine. But what I'm saying is that the men that are 6 feet tall versus the men that are 5'5", 5'6", they're not having less, those shorter men are not having less partners, they're having different partners. And that goes along with my, it's a sort of mating, it's similarity attraction hypothesis, that people typically, even if they want this, what's happening in real life is people are still kind of falling, and then there seems to be a percentage of men and a percentage of women that are higher in sociosexuality, they're more promiscuous, and they seem to be hooking up with each other. The majority of people have had one partner.
I'd be very reluctant to believe studies that deal with female promiscuity and them being honest and forthcoming about it. But you want to say something? Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say you're very smart, but I think that you talk too much.
Well, no, that's you know what? Totally fair. In my defense, when I got asked to be here, they told me there would be a switch.
In my defense,
they told me that they would bring on, they would have women like you on and then women like me on separately.
I'm not even coming at you like what is women like me, because we don't know each other.
Women who are I haven't heard you, maybe you're super equipped to have this conversation, but
I would just like to let other people speak.
Speak, no one's on your mic.
She thought this was going to be more of a debate. I think this is great. I think what they should do is just the two of them should square.
I agree, that's what I thought this was.
Also, the chat is finding this kind of like,
yeah, exactly. I disagree with you.
It's losing me a little bit. I'm not gonna lie. Like, that's why I say I'm not equipped to have this conversation. Yes. So it's like,
I disagree with you about the hypergamy thing. I absolutely.
Okay. We can have our own conversation
I'm just saying. Like, anecdotally, I'm confused that you don't see it either. If you go out on a regular basis, saying the women fighting for the same, like six women fighting for the same dude, I see it constantly, all the time. Dr. Scott Galloway, he agrees with me. Richard Reeves agrees with me. Like, there is an inequity when it comes to dating, and anecdotally, I see it. I see a dude with a 500 body count and several of my friends with three. I see that all over the place. But if you don't believe that that's a sign of hypergamy,
I don't want to take more people, but we can
talk about this outside of the podcast.